Don't even want to get out of bed. So much garbage happening in the world. It's just hard. It's really hard right now. How do you stay positive with so many things that you can't control happening to you? How do you stay positive when the government fights for 6 months just to give you like a $600 stimulus check? Your favorite restaurants are going out of business. Family can't get together during the holidays. How do you deal with that?
Are you freaking kidding me?
Won't you follow me into the jungle?
A week ago, my daughter's best friend from church commits suicide. I think there's a lot of people that are struggling with feeling alone. I think it's a lie that we tell ourselves all the time. No one cares about me. I'm not special. I'm alone. But the isolation of the pandemic all of a sudden takes this lie and covers it up in something that looks and feels very, very real. And there's a lot of people that just don't know how to deal with that. There's a ton of people right now that are hoping that 2021 is going to be a better year, and they're hoping it won't be a repeat of this last year. But I gotta tell you right now, there's a good chance it will be. And if you're not mentally prepared to step into your highest and best self, if you're not equipped with the skills I'm gonna teach you in this video, there's a good chance that sadness is gonna turn into depression. And depression ultimately turns into something a lot worse. You know, before there was a pandemic, there was already a need for this. How do you, my friend, stay positive during tough times? I mean, right now we've got this global thing going on, but no one makes it through life a decade without having a lot of tough times, right? We get jobs, we lose jobs, we step into dream relationships, then they end. We have problems with our diet and our body and our health. Like, life is constantly dishing up constant opportunity for challenge. Some of them are self-created, like your choices created that challenge. But also, just as legitimate, there's a ton going on in the world where other people's choices create a negative impact for you. And today I wanna talk about, what do you do to stay positive when all of that's going down, whether it's a pandemic or not? If anything, the pandemic is taking our problems and it's like pouring gas on the fire. Check out some of these headlines. The human cost of the pandemic, it's time to prioritize well-being. Suicides are on the rise right now. A year of people not being able to go to the gym. They've let themselves go. They look in the mirror and they don't like what they see. Mental health needs are on the rise for children and teens during the pandemic who thrive on socialization and being social and being out there. That's being stripped away and taken from so many of them. The job loss. Like, my wife and I just had the opportunity to help this one family out where both of them lost their job. They got six kids. How are they gonna like get through the holidays with that? It's been really hard on a lot of people. And then of course the pandemic, here, it's ended our marriage. The couple who split during the pandemic, right? There's just a lot going on right now, and it's very difficult for people to cope with that because our identities are rooted in not exactly who we are, but the things that we do. My identity is my job. If I lose my job, who am I? My identity is my relationship, or it's my body. And if I lose some level of control over those things, have I lost who I am? You know, before the pandemic, I told myself I'm this super successful dude. I travel the world every quarter. I'm traveling somewhere. Like, a lot of my identity is wrapped up in how many people I can help, how much business I can successfully do, how I grow my business, traveling with my family. This last year, I canceled all of my trips. Like, every time we were so close to going on a trip, it was yanked out like a rug from under our feet. We fell flat on our face. And for someone that believes that I need that novelty to thrive and now it's gone, how do I cope with that? Now, I get that that's like a first world problem, but for most of us here, Yoda comes to mind. You must unlearn what you have learned.
Jedi Master.
Society has kind of told us like how we should value ourselves and what we're worth. And the reality is when that's been taken away, it's up to you and I to decide, was that true? Or what am I supposed to learn through this? You know, I've been through my own fair share of adversity, and with the help of my coaches over the years, I've developed 3 strategies for overcoming my challenges so I could frame them up in a way where I could deal with them, I could face them head on, and then I could conquer them. But for you to really understand that, I want to go to this question right here, which is, what really makes you, you? Listen, there's a lot of messages out there, and I could get up here and preach a little bit about you're a son or daughter of God and you're enough. Reality is, I think that the choice that we've been given in life, our free agency, really gets to be used to build a lot of our own identity of who we are and what we choose to value. Society's already dished up a concept of that for you, but that's being challenged right now. So it's really time for you to awaken to the fact that you and I, we get to choose who we are. We get to choose what we believe. We get to choose what serves us. And that starts right here in the mind. I call it your mind palace. This is a place where you're deciding what you're good at and what you're bad at. Childhood, if anything, teaches us a lot of limiting ideas. I'm too dumb, I'm too fat, I'm too stupid, I can't do this, I'm not fast enough. You know, I'll never make the football team, or I'll never be good at makeup, I'm not pretty enough. And we build an identity around the things that we think about most. Some things are positive and some things are negative. And right now that negativity, it is bubbling up because it's what we're focusing on. And now we've got this identity confusion going on of, well, this must be who I am. I believe it is so important for you and I to actually learn how to overcome our challenges by actually understanding the difference between the lies that are readily available in life from truth. The idea that you're not good enough, that's an idea. And if you pour energy into it, you will become it. Similarly, you can invest in the notion that you're too fat.
Are you fat or what?
Leave me alone.
Dude, that will not motivate you to lose weight. That will not motivate you to go to the gym. If anything, it'll discourage you. If you choose to believe that you're not smart enough, that you weren't like the intellectuals that you hung out with when you were younger, or maybe it was a teacher that gave you a grade where you made this decision, I'm too stupid. You know how many adults that I meet today, they're like, hey, Chris, I can't invest in real estate because at the heart of it, I don't think I'm smart enough.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard.
That's just an idea. We're all intelligent. Sure, we're intelligent in different ways. I'm a total nerd when it comes to math. I can't do chemistry for the life of me. That doesn't make me stupid. It just means that there's different ways that we're intelligent. You want to see proof? Check this out from the Journal of Applied Scientists. They talk about negativity as a cycle that they've scientifically been able to prove will actually lose you money, lose you work opportunities, and leave you less fulfilled in life. Check this out. Entrepreneurs with a more negative outlook or lower levels of self-esteem, like satisfaction and optimism, tend to either lack personal development goals or frame them in the negative. For example, not make mistakes or I just need to survive this. These entrepreneurs were significantly less likely to achieve their goals. In other words, when you meet the negative Nancy's out there and the sky's always falling and it's half empty and you know all of that negativity that we talk about, those people scientifically, they get less in life, they feel less good about life, and I know because I've spent a lot of time with a lot of them doing a lot of my breakthrough work, which, by the way, is a gift I'm gonna give you at the end of this video for free. You know what's funny about this? It's kind of ironic, but I'm watching everyone more or less get what they want. Those that tend to be more negative will find the negativity. Those that are more positive will actually find the positivity, because the reality is every second we are taking in 20 million bits of information, but consciously our perception is sifting through 200, 300, or 400 bits that we can consciously interpret. That means that in any given second, there's all of this information available, the good and the bad, and you're ultimately gonna hone in on what you're searching for. And people that have a prime directive to see negativity, look for it, they hunt it down, and then they get rewarded with that bias. Listen, no doubt there's plenty that we can focus on being negative about in the world today, but I want to ask you something. Will that help you? Will that actually add to your happiness? Will that open up doors of opportunity, or is it going to freaking shut them on your face? It's going to shut you down. Which is why I want to share with you from what I've learned over the years from my own school of hard knocks, 3 ways to overcome adversity. There's no changing the fact that bad things are going to happen to you. That's just the reality of life. Sometimes it's because of our own choices that got us there. Sometimes it's because of somebody else's choices. And if you argue against that reality, you're going to lose every single time. So the first step in overcoming adversity, you've got to accept it. You've just got to realize this pandemic happened. I lost my job. This person's leaving me. This person commits suicide. Because if you argue it, then you're going to complain, you're going to whine, you're going to feel sorry, you're going to be depressed, and you're not going to let go. You're going to hold on to all that tension, you're going to hold all of that misery, and you're going to keep it inside of you. You got to get to the point where you say, hey, I accept it. And today, here's a phrase that I like to use. Today, I'm doing pain. Like, that's in my reality. That's something I experience. Have you ever accidentally smashed your toe against the wall, tripped on something? It's like, oh, mother. It like hurts like the Dickens. Guess what? It's just something that's happening in your existence. And you have to accept it if you actually want to let go of it. Or cold. Dude, I was in Alaska on this crazy hunt a few months back. And it's like for 10 days straight, every day was freezing or it was snowing and I was laying down 10 miles of track. There was no way to get around that. I was literally crossing through Arctic rivers. I can argue and say, oh my gosh, I hate the cold. The cold is like so painful. It's so horrible. Oh my gosh, it's like chilling to my bones. The more I think about it, the more I talk about it, the worse things get in my perception and the worse I believe my reality is versus just accepting it, saying today I'm doing cold. Dude, maybe you're having a problem with your mother-in-law. Great. So today you're dealing with mother-in-law. Just accept it. Accepting it may not sound very fun, but the reason why you're doing that is because you got to get to step two, which is you've got to learn from what happened. What's the most valuable lesson that I can get from this experience? You lose your job. What's the most valuable thing I can gain from this experience? Someone's mad at you. What's the most valuable thing I can learn from what I'm going through right now? You see, that question, it incites learning. And once we learn from something difficult, we're going to get something that often you can only get and appreciate through suffering. I think it's actually why it's built in maybe as a part of this divine design, that sometimes we have to go through something challenging and hard to learn the lesson because we might not be able to frankly learn it any other way. And if you want, you can take a long time to learn painful lessons or you can learn them fast. You accept it and then you go right to learning from it. Because once you get the lesson, you can move on to step three, which is to step into a space of gratitude. It creates an energy of closure. It says, thank you for teaching me this. Think of all the people right now there are to be angry at. You could be angry at your political party or your local officials for some policy they've enacted. You could be angry at a family member because of how they're choosing to social distance. And the reality is everyone's doing their best to get through a really hard, difficult situation, and you are either embracing the suck, the negativity, and just sucking it in like an energy vampire.
This is what I am.
Or you're finding a way to let it go. Gratitude is where you basically say, I'm here to accept it, get the lesson, and then I'm gonna say thank you because frankly, I'm a better person off with this knowledge, with this wisdom than before I had it. Well, Chris, this is good advice for like easy stuff. This is good advice for mid-level stuff. But what about when you've experienced something truly painful? What about when you've gone through something traumatic or something like my daughter who lost a friend to suicide? Could something like this really work? Well, I'm not saying it's easy, but here's what I am saying. Gratitude creates closure that leads to peace. My daughter can choose if she wants now to feel grateful for the time that she had with her friend or the experiences or the fun that they've had or the skills or the things that she's learned. There's always something to be grateful for. And gratitude is where you have to go if you want to get to the end of a cycle. Because if you don't get to the end, you can stay stuck. And the pain gets worse and the depression gets deeper. And before you know it, you've lost so much of your identity from the suffering that you're going through that there's a whole lot more at risk here. I'm sharing this with you because no matter what you've been through, at some point when you're ready to say, it's got to be in my past, you have to find a way to accept it. You have to find a way to learn from it. And you have to find a way to be grateful for it. No matter how hard it is, it will get you through. Now, I just shared with you my three hacks for how I deal with problems that happen externally to me, like suicide or loss of a job or something really challenging or difficult. But you know what the other half of the equation is that once we experience it out here, we find a way to internalize it. And then many of us are really hard on ourselves. So we allow these difficult experiences to reflect poorly on the value of our soul, who we really are as a human being. If I went through this, I must be worth less. If I lost my job, I can't provide for my family, then that means that I'm a loser or that I'm a failure. And so we internalize so harshly on ourselves. So I want to share one more thing with you today. I want to share with you something I call the success matrix, and it's a way that you can think positively through any adversity when it comes to how you internalize how you feel about yourself. We are super goal-oriented people. And so with this matrix across the top, We're setting goals and sometimes we're achieving them, yes, and sometimes we're achieving them, no. But on this side, I'm measuring lessons that are learned, because sometimes we do learn a lesson and sometimes we don't learn a lesson. And I believe there's a correlation between our ability to learn lessons and whether or not we actually achieve a goal. People work with me all the time. They're like, hey, Chris, I want to make more money. You might be a subscriber on this channel because you're like, Chris, I follow you because you've got amazing business hacks, real estate hacks. I'm here to become a financial genius, and I ultimately want that deeper mentorship with you. Well, what I'm going to share right now, for me, I think is going to be really mind-blowing for you, because it's going to show you how I think successfully about myself internally, no matter what I experience. And most of the time that you set an aggressive goal, you're not going to achieve it. Most of us even decided in childhood that we deserve to try something 1, 2, or 3 times. And if we can't figure it out, then we're a failure. The reality is, as an adult, you understand that things that are truly worthwhile sometimes take 10 tries or 30 tries or hundreds of tries. In fact, if you admire anyone that has become insanely successful out there, you learn the real story of Michael Jordan or Oprah Winfrey or Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, these icons that we look to, these are people who have suffered and failed more than most, but they found a different mindset internally that allowed them to become successful. I'm going to show you what that looks like right now. You see, let's just assume for a moment that you set a goal. You're working with me, you want to double your income this year. So you've got your goal, and guess what? You achieve the goal and you've learned amazing lessons along the way, because you had to learn how to do things to create a new result. What would you call it if you actually got your goal and you learned everything that allowed you to achieve the goal? You and I would probably call that success. And you'd probably say, Chris, if that happened and when that happens, I feel really amazing as a human being. But what happens if you set out to achieve a goal and you didn't achieve it, but you learned why? You actually learned the lessons that might enable you in the future to have a better shot at succeeding. Do you know what I would call that? You don't get the goal, but you actually learn the lesson. I would also call that success. Now, I know some of you are thinking, yeah, but Chris, that's like less success, right? I'm going to tell you right now that the moment you start saying there's great success and less success, you're limiting your mind. What would you call it, however, if you set a goal and you've gotten so good at getting this goal that you stop learning? There's nothing new to learn. What would you call that? I would call that success. In my real estate game for the last 7, 8 years, I haven't learned anything new. We've gotten so good at it that there's like nothing left to know or learn. It's like a finite science where 0.0001 decimals is significant to us, and we've mastered the game of how to play it. So by the way, if you know how to produce a result and there's nothing new to learn, that's not bad, that's good. In all three of these scenarios, I'm successful. Sometimes I get my goal, sometimes I don't. I'm successful no matter what, except for one condition. What happens if you don't achieve your goal and you don't learn anything new? Which, by the way, I would argue most unlearned, unmentored people do. They don't get what they want, and instead of asking why, they internalize, I'm a failure, there's something wrong with me, or I can't figure it out, or I don't know how to do it. Those are the wrong lessons. Those are the false lessons of a child's mind. Here's what this is, though. This isn't failure. If you, in fact, don't get the goal and you don't learn anything, it's because you are instead choosing to create a story. That's a fancy word for victimhood, which is you telling yourself and other people, well, I tried to do this thing and then I couldn't get it because this happened and this was out of my control. Kind of like what we're facing in the world today with the pandemic. I'm just telling you right now that instead of a story, instead of victimhood, when you don't get what you want, you've got to ask why, you've got to get the lesson. And then if you do, you program yourself. I'm successful when I do that. Because guess what? Sometimes I got to try something truly worthy 100 times. How many light bulbs did Edison have to build? Think about Graham Bell building the first telephone. Think of what they had to go through to bring about like those amazing feats that we get to enjoy every single day. It's because they found a way to be okay trying something and not getting it as long as they valued the lesson. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you can value the lesson more than the thing that you're trying to get, you're already a successful person, and now it's eventual. It's just an inevitability. It's a matter of time before you actually get the thing that you want. You know, over the years, I've had the opportunity to help thousands and thousands of people learn the game of money and how to succeed at it. And the reality is, It's a challenging game for most people in the beginning until they really learn the rules or they get the right mentor or they get the right system. But I quickly learned that no one was really going to have success even with the right system if they had a weak mindset. And so over the years, I've paid millions of dollars to my mentors and I've asked this question, what is the ultimate mindset for winning? And for me, it's what I call a limitless mindset. I wrote a book about it, and you don't hear me talking a lot about this book on this channel, but I want to tell you that this is the most important contribution that I've made in my life to date. This book entails how you take suffering, traumas, difficult situations in life, whether it's loss of relationships or can't get over certain heartbreaks or businesses that failed, and this helps you overcome them. It's a strategy I developed for breaking through my limiting beliefs and exchanging them for positive, empowering beliefs. Just like that journal of study said, it says that positive people are more successful in life. They're happier, they get more out of life. And so ultimately I figured out that we've got to figure out how to cultivate that mindset. Once I mastered it, I wrote a book about it. And in the link below today, I've got some extra copies of this. If you click the link and you see that it's available, grab your free copy. You just got to cover the shipping and handling. Read this book. This is a summation of the millions of dollars I've spent working with some of the most brilliant minds, men and women, who have truly succeeded and transcended challenge and difficulty in life. And I believe, especially right now more than ever, that this book will be a godsend to you, to your family, to your loved ones, and help you pick up the pieces so that you can put together your most brilliant life this coming year. You know, there's a lot of people that make themselves feel better by telling themselves that money doesn't buy happiness. And the reality is, if you want, you can find evidence for that. But you know what? You can also find evidence that having money solves problems. Having money allows you to be a greater contributor in society. Having money allows you to simply do more with life. And that's a belief that I personally have. So if you're sitting here right now watching this video thinking, man, Chris, if I cultivated a better mindset and also had more opportunity for making more money so that I could literally on a weekly basis either have enough to get out of my job or just be better off or maybe get ahead during these uncertain times, I would be in a better situation. This video series right here was made for you, my friend. It's about my friend who nearly lost his job during the pandemic and panicked saying, how do I replace six figures? And I showed him how to do it in less than 30 days. Check out the video and click the link below to get a free copy of your book, Limitless, to help make your life better this next year.